Hejsan och välkomna. Hello all and welcome to this session about secure digital communication. My name is Åke Wislander and I'm joining you from a company called Inuit. And I am joined today by two esteemed guests. Please introduce yourselves, guys.
Yes, I'm Tim Engelkes and I work for Cryptshare. Secure email solution from Germany, and we work for a long time now with Inuit. So thank you for having us.
Yeah, my name is Anders Junkist, working with the Signicat. Currently also working out of the German office, but happily today in Stockholm together with Inuit and Cryptshare.
Great, and let's start with that, because I think we will shortly will discuss about why we're actually having this session. But just to place this, because I think many people know Bank ID, but who are actually Signicat?
Signicat is a company actually out of Trondheim in Norway. Very early on with the Norwegian Bank ID.
Mm-hmm.
And was dragged on, this is way back in the 2005-06, started the company in 2007 and was early then dragged into all the e-identities in the Nordics.
Mm, okay.
Where we are lucky that in all the Nordic countries, including Finland, there is a national identity.
Yeah.
Three of them based up on the bank certificates and the Danish one on the public one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that is the basic for the company to aggregate and put those together and then provide services on that on APIs. So what we have done, for example, with Cryptshare, that we are here today, that is an integration between the identity services from Signicat and the encryption technology and mail facilities from Cryptshare.
Great. So, guys, what are we actually here to discuss today?
Well, actually, to also announce that we are live now with our integration.
Yeah.
So that we are able to send an encrypted email and add an extra layer of authentication on it, and really the missing part. From my perspective, was really the proof of identity of the person that you send a message to.
Yeah.
And that was we were actually quite happy with this. With this cooperation now, with this integration.
So if you're looking at the wider aspect, it's more than just that. It's more of a why are we still seeing that there's so many secure sensitive information that's still not being sent securely.
Yeah, it's yeah. Probably because a lot of people think, probably a hassle for them.
Yeah.
To email is actually the most simple platform there is to exchange information, but asking somebody to log in somewhere and then send a message. That is extremely extremely difficult. We have our customers, actually Cryptshare solution is quite a actually a very easy to use solution, but there was one thing missing, and that was actually the proof of identity. And as you told us about a year ago already, that how many people are used to work with Bank ID. Many people are just so easy, so user-friendly it is, the solution to identify yourself.
Yeah.
If you can add that to an email,
yeah,
then you don't have to log into to portals, to all difficult ways to communicate. You can just send an email, and we encrypt the email, and the Bank ID makes sure that we have the proof of identity. So the actual person that you're sending it to is also opening the email.
Yeah.
And that is a win-win situation.
Yeah.
I think we've seen also that during this COVID, unfortunately through this COVID days, the way of communicating electronically and has sort of increased it tremendously.
Yeah.
And username password has been under this super duper attacks.
Yes.
During the last 2 years, so unfortunately the last 1.5. So the requirement to sort of know who is sending and who is receiving,
yeah,
that's getting extremely essential. I don't have the numbers in my head, but the frauds and sort of phishing attempts have gone up dramatically the last years.
Yeah. So Anders, you guys have been working a long time in secure identity handling. Do you spot any trends other than this you just mentioned with COVID?
We see that this is spreading out. I mean, it started very, we are in Stockholm, Sweden today, and BankID is, of course, announced and been distributed from the banks originally.
Yeah.
But I mean, we've seen this now, it's emerged into a lot of areas. Insurance companies is using it all over the place. Started with the self-declaration of your healthcare and a healthcare declaration, but now used as a convenience to log into any, if Storebrand, whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Same in all the healthcare.
Yeah.
Probably the most popular one with the young people in Sweden is Kry, the healthcare app.
Yeah.
So we see it goes into property lending, verify yourself, and you're bidding for stuff and you're buying stuff.
Yeah.
Klarna, anyone is using the bank ID in their either in their apps or in their applications.
Honestly, if I look at myself, for instance, I don't know if I would go through one day without using bank ID ever. I use it all over the place. It's everywhere.
That's the same
and,
for me.
And I think the last number that I saw is that in Sweden it's used by 95% of the people. I can still imagine that maybe some of the older people who, for instance, do not have a smartphone or something like that, might still be not using it, so to speak. But other than that, for me, it's just natural. It is.
It's part of the
In other countries, I know for instance in Germany, it's like 10% that's using their national bank ID, isn't it?
Yeah, and EID is it's probably lower than that as well. And so the Nordics are kind of way ahead in the usage, but we see that all Central Europe is coming along quite dramatically. And one of the benefits you see in the Nordics is the fact that it's both used for government and private sector.
Yes,
the cross-border one, and sort of to introduce this also into a straightforward email solution.
Yeah,
sort of just adds another capability into your normal day with a good security level.
Mm. Because it was pushed from the commercial side first, wasn't it?
Yeah,
and since the government and the legislations didn't actually have any better alternative, they sort of pushed that out as well, didn't they?
Yeah. And this is also about trust. The whole thing is about trust, and that's why I think we also go into two-factor and these kind of because I mean you receive something from a person and it's using BankID that delivers your trust. In the Nordics we have like 80% trust both in government and banks. Go to Germany, it's about 40%.
Yeah.
And you go to our friends in the US, it's about 20.
Yeah.
And even less for the government. So to sort of have that trust, I mean, in Switzerland, we had something called Swiss ID.
Yeah.
They actually had a national vote in March.
Okay.
That could be used both for private and public.
Mm.
It was turned down.
Ah, okay.
Because they said, why should a private company also be the login for healthcare and public services.
Mm.
So then you have another trust in, because they trust their cantons, not the public again.
Oh, okay.
So by doing what we are doing now together with Critshare, then we leverage a trust level into email also.
Yeah.
Because that's what people are searching for.
Mm. Mm. So on a more general level, we live in a digital area, in a digital time, so to speak, and as beings in that time, we expect things to be faster, more convenient, more secure, and why do we still see so many processes that are analog, or unsecure, I should say. I mean, we all have these examples, Why do you think that?
I mean, probably all people are born kind of a little bit conservative in the way of changing stuff, but you have to take it step by step then, because when you introduce when you start to introduce a secure element which is convenient, like bank ID,
yeah,
you start sort of to really dig into the digital processes in the company.
Yeah.
I don't know anyone. I mean, a lot of people use bank ID, but in the bank ID there is a lot of attributes. It's your first name, last name. It's your birth date. We can combine those with a social. In Sweden, we can do the social security number. Look that up in registers. So you can actually collect a lot of information.
Okay.
So if you start with a secure element to sort of log into something or open up an email or whatever. But the company, if you use it on the website, etc., you can also collect the information and start to populate your CRM systems, your backend databases.
Yeah.
So we see some neobanks, for example, they use all this information to sort of check your credit risks, Bisnode, Experian, and then they can start to automate business processes.
Yeah.
But that takes quite a long time, because then it's not the technology in the front end. It's a reprocessing or your business process. It's not only providing a new technology.
No, no.
But very often companies start with something like encryption of an email.
Yeah.
But then after a while they see a possibility that this could really be re-engineering a lot of our digital processes. Mm. That takes a lot of time.
Yeah.
So I think it's important to sort of just introduce the technology and the security elements in something you are used to use, then, like an email,
yeah,
like logging into a bank, logging into to a website, or do a 3D secure for a MasterCard purchase, for example.
Yeah, yeah. So let's do some examples to see if people that are listening recognize themselves. I think processes that, at least for myself, I think it definitely could benefit from being digitized. Let's talk, for instance, about sending and receiving documents to and from banks as a personal individual, so to speak. Medical information.
Yeah.
I mean, I know for a fact that I've been asked to send medical information. Even by fax,
you shouldn't do.
Yeah. And I suppose social security matters in the commune, for instance, information about students in the schools that either is sent on security or is sent purely analog, because you cannot send it through digital ways, so to speak.
Now, the biggest problem there is for many people is that they, for example, for a bank, you have a banking app, or you have your banking platform or whatever. But it's just a single, single point of a message. Eh? It's just one way.
Yeah.
And also with medical information, it's. And the hospital puts your medical information in your portal, but you can't respond to it. If you actually want to have a conversation with your doctor or with somebody, then 9 out of 10 times it's just over email. But it was actually just over plain email, so not really, that secure. Because of that fact, and because of also our customers asking for it. Well, that was actually the spot on reason why we're here now.
Yeah.
To add that proof of identity, so you are able to communicate in a fully encrypted way with your doctor, talk about your medical condition or your insurance policy if you have questions about that. But then you just have ad hoc emailing, and then fully encrypted, fully secured, and authenticated with your bank ID. I think a lot of people would, or a lot of companies would benefit from that.
Yeah.
Because we spoke last week. You also gave me an example about what was it? Your insurance policy.
You tried
to communicate with your.
Yeah, and let's take another example. I mean, I don't think that there is a single viewer looking at this that has not, either on this work or the one before that, yeah, or the one before that, have been asked by their employer, their new employer, to, yeah, please provide your bank account, your next of kin, mm, your phone number, your personal number, your home address.
Copy of your ID.
And all of this is sent, yeah, via an unencrypted mail.
Yep.
I mean, it's, yeah, not that difficult to make it secure, is it?
It is difficult. No. I mean, you see that on the on that, what I said, triggered off our way into the insurance companies with the healthcare declaration.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you get accepted as with a policy, mm, they send that that policy back in an open, yeah, email.
Yes.
And it actually tells that you have put up for a healthcare insurance.
Yes.
So, and then that pretty confidential information, just the confirmation paper with that.
Yes. Yeah.
That policy included.
Yes. Yes. So. Let's address one of the elephants in the room then, because for me anyway, what about the legal requirements? Do we think that there's legal, some sort of legality set up regarding this? Is the legislation today guiding us in this, or should it?
I think what people, if you ask CIOs or CISO officers in larger companies or, yeah, even in smaller companies, they've been focusing extremely on the GDPR part,
yes, yes,
to protect any personal information that flows back and forth. I mean, that can give you up to 4% of your revenue in a fine, according to the rules then. If you go into bank finance sector, which is maybe more frightening for them, that is coming now, it's the anti-money laundering, the AML part.
Mm.
That is not only a fine, that's more lose your job and go to jail. So that is coming up with something called MiFID 5 and MiFID 6 things. We've seen this anti-money laundering, for example, Danske Bank through Baltics, for example.
Yeah.
Their chairman, CEO, etc., had to leave their positions.
Yeah. Mm.
So to understand and to sort of fit into the regulations according to who is the actual sender and who is the actual receiver of, if it's money or if it's a mortgage or whatever. Mm. And we see that AML thing is growing. I mean, if I use Germany as an example, any house rental contracts with more than 10,000 euro per month,
mm,
that's probably in the professional market, but that's an AML transaction.
Yes.
Mm. So it's not only transferring money on a bank account.
No.
It's any transaction that is over above a given level.
Mm.
It's a possible anti-money laundering stuff.
Yeah.
Mm. So that is creeping in all of the stuff, but in all areas. But I think the laws are always behind the real world kind of thing.
Yes.
Then.
Yes.
Mm. So, but it's catching up. Yeah, definitely.
Mm.
And that's why we see, for example, the classic old username passwords are, mm, more or less disappearing, because, yeah, you're immediately on the risk zone.
Yeah. Mm. Because the human brain can only remember so many passwords. Yeah. It's all over the place.
It's all over the place. Yeah.
Yeah.
We all know those tricks. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. So Tim, the solution that we've been working with for many years now with from you guys, it that on a higher level, it sort of it takes the email, it converts it into a file, it encrypts it. All of this is done in the background. It uploads it to a virtual server in your own premises or in a cloud environment. And then that virtual server sends out a message to the recipient,
yeah,
that there is something to fetch from this server. And, yeah, and the recipient does not have any requirements at all to install software,
No.
Well, the only thing that they have to do is to verify that they are the intended recipient.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
They can do that by an SMS code or through bank ID now, yeah, or through a password that you share with them in some. But that is the automation is sort of the secret in the solution, isn't it? That it's so simple. It's simple for the users internally.
Yeah.
Because it's only a button in their Outlook.
Yep.
To touch, so to speak, to send it securely, other than sending it normally, and it's simple for the recipient as well, because they don't have to have any software installed or go to any specific place or anything
no.
like that.
No.
There's no requirement that they have to do it on a special type of machine. They can do it on an iPhone or an iPad or a computer or a
yeah, sounds like a perfect solution.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
But yeah, if you want people to employees or anybody, if you want them to be able to respond to a secure message, or you want your office employees to be able to send a message securely, then you have to keep it very simple. If you work from Outlook, for example, you want to press one button and then the message encrypts, and
yeah,
you don't want to go to another platform or to another portal or to those are all extra extra things an employee have to do, and time is precious.
So this is sort of a tech talk, and let's discuss then what happens with an email that you don't send securely. How is that transferred to the recipient?
Well, it goes over, I don't know, we spoke about it
it's
yesterday.
It's like a postcard, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like a postcard.
It's like information with a postcard, and it's transferred through a number of nodes and servers, and there's like, it could be 20 administrators that has access to reading this in full format, and
Have to be careful what you put in the subject as well.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it goes to other countries.
so we do have some listeners, viewers actually sending in some questions. Let's see if that's this. One question now is: your solution, is it only on premise, or is it also possible to have it in the cloud? And where do these mails, this communication that you use, where is it stored? Where is it encrypted?
All right, yeah.
That goes to you.
Mm? Well, so if you have the on-premise solution, which is available, then the message are on your premise. So the server is located in your own environment.
Normally in your DMC or something.
Yeah, exactly.
A virtual server.
Yep. Yeah. Mm. If you want to have it in the cloud, that is also possible. It can be hosted in the Microsoft in Azure in the marketplace. You can actually quite easily set up a CryptShare server. We have a hosting service ourselves. There are partners of us that can host the service, but the customer is actually always the only person who has complete control over the server. So it is not a cloud solution. It can be hosted, but the customer always has the control over the server, and they can also determine, okay, I want to be able to read back my when I want to upload a file, I want it to be like for 10-day retention time or something, or 5-day retention time, and you can make it even shorter or longer, but in most cases it's about a week that you retrieve a file. But the best part is it's 9 out of 10 times it's in your own environment. So
And one of the key things is that it's all about integrity, isn't it? Because normally, for instance, I've worked with IT now and IT security for about 16 years or something.
No.
And it's normally when you set up a solution, it's there's a administration, some sort of place where you can go to administer the solution, so to speak. And there is in Cryptshare as well. But what if one of the users sends a mail, encrypts it, and forgets about the password? Is there an administrator that actually can access that information from the server?
Well, the user itself
can
do that. That's the whole point, that we don't want everybody in the company to be able to retrieve passwords.
No,
we just want the sender to be able to get his password, and the person, of course, receiving the message.
Yeah.
But if you are a user, you're working from Outlook, for example, then you have just like two extra buttons that makes you able to send an encrypted email.
Yeah.
It makes you able to cancel the transaction. So, for example, you send something, you send an attachment, and you realize that you didn't send it all, or you forgot a document. Then you can also just cancel the full transaction. Mm. You can indeed retrieve the password if you forgot about it, and send it over again to the person. And now with Bank ID, you don't have any exchange of passwords at all, and that's even the best part.
I think that's, having worked with security for a long time and encrypted mail, I mean that's sort of always been the problem, hasn't it?
Yeah.
How to share the password.
Yeah, and we have indeed.
How do you do that? And even more so if you're doing it one to many.
Yeah.
For like an institution or a hospital or that's always the problem.
Exactly. If you have a conversation with your solicitor, with your lawyer, for example, and you have like 10 messages in an hour, then you have to think of 10 different passwords.
I may be wrong, but people tend to find ways around security matters.
Yeah.
Unless they're really simple to use.
Yeah.
Like encrypted mail, for instance. How many times have we seen that an encrypted mail has been sent to a recipient, and then in either the same mail or another mail sent through the same system is where you share the password.
Yeah.
Because of convenience. Because I don't know the phone number, and I don't have an SMS gateway installed, so I can't do that.
Yeah.
I'll just send them. And that sort of takes away the benefit of actually doing an encrypted transaction, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I mean,
that's where the magic happens with Bank ID, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you asked about sort of examples and stuff. One thing that popped up, especially now during the last difficult 2 years, is board meetings.
Yeah.
Papers from board meeting.
Yeah.
There are some new portals that set up, but a lot of that goes on mail.
Yeah.
And it's distributed from the one who's taking the notes, and a lot of confidential information. So we've seen that sort of whop.
Yeah.
Can we encrypt that one?
Yeah.
Oh, why haven't we thought about that before then?
Mm.
And that's it's a one-to-many.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Thing, and so a very often thing. Same with when you do the diligence stuff, etc. A lot of confidential information floating back and forth then.
Yeah.
So it's not only contracts and healthcare, it's spreading out then.
Yeah.
The reason is really that you can use something like Bank ID because that's something you trust them.
Yes, exactly. Mm. Mm. So when a company or an institution tries to set up a secure communication, where the internal user needs to communicate to either one or many recipients, what type of numbers could they hit?
What do you mean? Sorry.
What type of problems could they hit
with using Cryptshare?
Yeah. No. Setting up any secure communication. What type of problems?
Yeah. Well, they can.
I mean, they could be like what type of platform do we have, what type of skill set do we have, for instance, in the...
You already mentioned downloading software or not, or...
Exactly,
Yeah, if I speak for us for Cryptshare, it's quite like you mentioned before, it's quite basic. It's fairly easy. And again, you don't want to make it very complicated. You want to make it as simple as possible. You want your employee to communicate securely. Then, don't let him jump any hoops or think of any of passwords or logging into services or whatever. He's used to communicate via Outlook. Give him the means to work with that, and that's absolutely what we do.
I see that we actually have a question from one of the viewers that ties into this topic actually. So the question is, if I received an encrypted mail from, for instance, a public institution, how can I, as a recipient, having not bought this solution, answer this mail?
Yeah, quite easily.
Encrypted and securely. No, I mean, we have in Sweden, we have this encrypted email box, so to speak, called Kivra, for instance. That's a one-way communication.
So you
send an information. It's more like an encrypted messaging board,
to speak.
You can see it, but you can't respond to it. How can you use that in Cryptshare?
Well, for the example of the viewer, the organization that communicates with you. So in this case, it was a public organization that sends to a person, right? An actual person. So when they send an email, they said that the person needs to identify with bank ID.
Yep.
Or he receives a notification email saying, okay, dear Mr. Or Mrs. Etc. And you received a message from this organization, and then go to either the link or press reply or press download the message, and then actually the bank ID pops up. You do your thing with bank ID, you authenticate, and then you will be automatically brought into the web server, actually, to you have your message, and you can retrieve your files, or you can straight away reply to it. Emails used quite frequently to email back and forth. So in that screen, you can just simply reply to the message. And add maybe a file you need to send back, or you need to sign, for example.
Because it's simple as that. That's also kind of one of the key things, isn't it? We're talking about secure digital communication.
Not a one-way street.
Not flask post, bubble post. I mean, it's a two-way street. It has to be.
Yeah.
Be able to do it back and forth. So I'm really happy about that question. Actually, it sort of shows one of the problem areas that we see. So what type of costs could you cut down if you use these digital processes rather than the analog ones?
That's a very good question.
We
should calculate that.
I mean, if you take away the fax and all the unsecured parts, then you are into the post office and the DHL delivery. I work in Germany.
Yes, exactly.
And I got a public project now.
Yeah.
And I physically now send DHL envelopes with signed documents every week. It's about €50 every time I put it into an envelope.
Yes. Yeah.
They don't accept the digital signed stuff then.
No, but so. Yeah, exactly. And if you start to look at this, there are so many costs that you cut down. I mean, the companies and the organizations that has not yet went down the entire digital route, so to speak. Obviously, there's one or many reasons why they haven't. They see obstacles for doing so, obviously. But if you look at it, building a business case for this actually quite small investment in setting this up, there are so many business benefits, so many costs that you reduce. I mean, staff costs, postage, the security of a fax, for instance. In a legal way, the fax is still a legal manner of communicating a signed document, for instance.
It is. But I mean, if
how
you
secure is the on the receiving end? How do you know that the person that you sent the fax to is actually the one who goes and gets it from the fax machine?
Yeah. No control. I think that today you have. I mean, what this open up? It is a way to do secure, convenient. You are what you do today. You either go down the unsecure way, or you go the call the manual handling way, which is costly.
Yeah.
So if you want to be secure, you go the manual one. Yes. Now we have an intermediate that you can be secure on in a digital route.
Yeah.
And I think the pressure from CISOs and regulatory, if you want to comply with your ISO certificates, your SOC certificates, your TÜV certificates, whatever, which is getting more and more mandatory if you're going to do contracts with, especially in the B2B side, and also communicating B2C, then the unsecure way goes away. Then you are not compliant anymore with your certificates or your your policies. So that's you either have to go the manual way or the call it a new digital way then.
So
that's maybe the call it the genius of what we are talking about today, and that you can actually do it on a secure on an email, it's a giant step into a digital secure way.
I know that we have another question here that also ties into this. So I can see on the Signicut homepage that it has support for many EID solutions, so to speak. Is there a possibility to get support for those in Cryptshare as well? I know, for instance, when we were having dinner a couple of nights ago, we talked about the SIT standard, for instance, that is used within the public organizations and the healthcare sector.
The basis has been built, and the connection is made with the platform. So, in theory, we can connect with every method that's available on Signicut.
Yes.
So we need a couple of weeks, but not not a couple of months.
No.
Just.
I mean, the plan here is to go all the way together.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think currently in the platform is to cover Europe is about 50 different methods. It goes all the way from a convenient Swedish bank ID to a little bit complicated video ident in Germany.
SPID
in Italy.
EID.
EIDIN in the Dutch market. So we have started a. We are going down a path, a route to cover Europe for this together.
Definitely. Yeah.
No doubt.
So Tim, what type of industries would you like to see converting to this? I mean, naturally, you would like to see them all do that.
Yeah.
But in the first instance, what?
Well, I can see, and that's also from my personal experience when changing my mortgage for my bank, for example. So the financial is one industry I would really like to push for. Insurance, all everything concerned with financial personal financial data. You just have to be. And maybe it's a personal thing, but I would want to be get the secureness, get a secure feeling.
Yeah.
If you are communicating with a bank, then you don't just send an email; you just send an encrypted email.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Added with, in my case, then EIDIN in Holland, but bank ID in Sweden. What do you think? What do you think is the it's the best industry.
Well, yes, I think definitely financial. There should be a strong need for it.
Yeah.
Absolutely, because I know for a fact that the financial sector are using encrypted communication, digital secure communication today. But I don't think that they're using it in to the extent that they should do. I think they're using it when they're communicating to other businesses, systems, when they're communicating information about transactions and stuff like that. But I don't think that they're using it fully when communicating, for instance, with the customers.
No,
and stuff like that.
And then we haven't even talked about it. But you can also automate with scriptures. Eh? So sending your as an insurance company, for example, sending your personal insurance policy papers. Then you don't have to send it individually, but you can also do that with scripture and automate the whole process.
I know that we have quite a few of the viewers today that is from a public sector, sitting in this public sector today. And we did have an interesting question now. Do we know that government authorities and such will be able to approve this solution? Today, many of these digital communications are not being approved by the legal entities of those. Mm. Do we know that it will be approved?
Good question.
I think that sort of ties into again the legislation, and because legislation is not that precise, it's always up to the different entities to decide themselves. But we could take some examples where it has been approved.
Well, we have several. We have quite a few customers.
For instance, Konkurrensverket here in Sweden is already using this solution.
Yeah.
We have a number of the regions already using this solution.
Yeah.
The bank finance regulations is covered.
Yes.
There might be some, at least to verify on some of the government areas for DIG, etc., to see to get that approval. Been done in Norway and Denmark, for example.
Yeah.
BaFin is another one, and it's the toughest one in the finance in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
So this is an ongoing process all the time then. And you all have to update this then, because it's always linked into the law.
Yeah.
And you try to interpret the law into a business.
Yes.
So even if you say you can't even tell government is government, it could be a different interpretation of the law. In for example, in the healthcare, or if you go to the Skatteverket or the tax authorities,
exactly,
but it could be different even in the government.
Yes. Mm.
So that is something we work.
It's all about the interpretation of the law.
Of the law,
it? Yeah. Mm.
And we also see that in Europe there is a more harmonizing some of these laws among the EU.
Mm.
So a lot of the stuff we are doing together is confirming to what you call EIDAS, which is the certification in the European area.
Yeah.
Mm. So I think that could be found. A lot of that could be found on both on CryptShare and Syndicate the websites.
Yes.
To see at least where we know where it's at.
Yeah.
Of course, that's something we discuss with anyone.
Yeah. Yeah. So we didn't actually have, I see that we're coming up on the last minute now of the show, so to speak, the session, but we did have an idea when talking about this yesterday, and I'd like to throw this out there to the viewers, even though we haven't had time to prepare, but I think we will be sending out invites for those who wants to join us in a session where we actually demo this solution in an open web format like this as well. So you don't have to book any individual demo slots or something like that. I think there might be benefits of actually being able to see the solution.
Seeing is believing.
Yes. Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. Yeah. And we can also show then how easy it is to verify yourself with Bank ID in a mobile phone, for instance.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. So thank you guys for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
And thank you for having viewed the session. I hope you enjoyed it. See you soon.